Danny put this plot up on the screen, and we all looked at it, and we were like, wow, that looks a lot like what we're looking for.
We observed Proxima Centauri with the Parkes Murray-Yang Telescope in April 2019. We thought that it would be good for the student program in 2020.
So I didn't really see the signal until the very end of my internship when I was putting together all of the data and figures, final figures that I had generated and looking through them for potential candidates. And this one had stuck out to me because it fit all of our criteria when we're looking for a signal. It was only present in our on observations as we look towards the source, and then it was not present in any of the off observations as we were looking away from the source in the sky with the Parkes telescope. We expect an emitter that has non-radial acceleration relative to Earth to have a drift in frequency, and so that could tell us that it's either a satellite or even something on the surface of Proxima Centauri B, which is one of the possibly habitable planets orbiting Proxima Centauri.
I was attending a Breakthrough Listening group meeting. Andrew Simeon said, I've never seen something like this before. We should really have someone start working on follow-up. So I volunteered, and that's how I started working on this potential candidate. We definitely referred to it as the weird signal from Parkes for a couple weeks until that just became kind of unwieldy to type out in Slack, honestly. The switch to the nomenclature of BLC1 didn't happen because it passed some sort of threshold or there was some formal meeting. It just kind of caught on because we needed a shorthand in our discussions. At this point, I started assigning tasks to other team members so we could get things done in parallel. We had other team members looking into the characteristics of the off sources that we chose because maybe those off sources had enough radio brightness inherently that they would wash out the signal. We also started going back and looking for signals like BLC1 in any other observation we'd taken over the course of the last year of Breakthrough Listen work at Parkes. It was about a couple weeks after that when we had this information on the drift rates, when we had this information on seeing this signal again throughout the observation week, and it provided pretty strong circumstantial evidence that we were dealing with RFI. And that's about the time the Guardian article came out.
When the Guardian article came out, it was really exciting because I had never really been a part of something that had gotten that sort of like media attention.
Most of the media that came out of that was actually quite positive. None of it was saying like, oh my gosh, Breakthrough Listen found aliens, but instead treating it, the subject, pretty respectfully and doing a pretty good job sticking to the science. And so that was nice. At the same time, we were not ready to talk about this, not because we were trying to keep it secret or anything, but because the analysis wasn't done.
The media buzz certainly influenced us in that we realized that we really need to be 100% confident on what the signal is before we say anything else. And so we needed to make sure that we did the most rigorous and comprehensive analysis of this signal before we made any conclusions.
So we went back and Shane Smith and I ran one of our algorithms to try and pull out any signals that started with the same drift. And at the end of that, we found about 30 signals that had identical shapes to BLC1. And all of these signals showed up no matter where the telescope was pointed. So to find 30 things that looked exactly alike was pretty telling. And if only one of those things looked like it was coming from the sky, but the other 29 were clearly from the Earth, probably something weird just happened and BLC1 was actually a part of this set. For now, all we can say for sure is it's two different Earth-bound transmitters mixing with each other. So, definitely not aliens.
Even though we found that this signal is radio interference and not the alien technosignature that we were looking for, it still the fact that we found it through our pipelines is really comforting because it means our pipelines are doing what they're supposed to do. We're in a good spot because we have the tools, the technology, and the capability to find these signals. In the future, I think the thing that's the most exciting will be the other telescopes that will come online. And one of the more exciting ones that will be coming on for us in the next coming months is the Meerkat telescope. This is a telescope in South Africa. There are 64 dishes, and we'll be getting all the signals from those 64 dishes and combining them. So with that, we'll be able to do things that we can't do with the current technology that we've been using.